Hello all, welcome to the show. I'm Gus Gagliardi and this is Fire Code Tech. On Fire Code Tech, we interview fire protection professionals from all different careers and backgrounds in order to provide insight and a resource for those in the field. My goal is to help you become a more informed fire protection professional. Fire Code Tech has interviews with engineers and researchers, fire marshals, and insurance professionals, and highlights topics like codes and standards, engineering systems, professional development, and trending topics in the industry. So if you're someone who wants to know more about fire protection or the fascinating stories of those who are in the field, you're in the right place.
Welcome to episode 46 of Fire Code Tech. On today's episode, we're talking with Jeyra Rivera. In our episode today with Jeyra, we talk about plenty of professional development tips and tricks and lots of interesting information about the burgeoning new career of Jeyra. Today's episode is an inspiring story about how you can too make a transition into fire and life safety and what are the resources that you need to be successful in your career. We dive deep into professional development topics and pull out some real gems like how to stay competitive as somebody who is just getting into the field and might be stranded in a remote work situation. Jeyra talks about her superpower, which is finding and cultivating mentor relationships. If you're looking for some interesting information on how to stay competitive, or you just want to hear an inspiring story of a young professional who is going places, you're going to love this episode. Don't forget to hit subscribe wherever you're listening to your podcasts, and give us a 5-star review if you wouldn't mind on Google Play, Apple Podcasts, Spotify, or wherever you get your info. Also, do follow us on LinkedIn. That's where we post most frequently. And you can find out about all the different life safety and fire information that we post about.
Jeyra, thank you so much for coming on the podcast. Welcome to Fire Code Tech.
Thank you so much for having me. Very excited to be here with you today.
Awesome. Well, I love starting these interviews with a little bit of your background and to get the listeners acquainted with about your story and just how you kind of professionally got started.
Of course. So, like you mentioned, my name is Jeyra Rivera Arocho. I am a fire protection engineer at Smith Group, and I pivoted actually from mechanical engineering to fire protection. So, that's pretty much how, and kind of a elevator pitch version of my career. And I guess as we go, we're going to, you know, keep elaborating about my history and like my story and how I evolve as an engineer.
Sure. So I understand that you recently just completed schooling and, you know, kind of finished your program and had some internships. Could you tell me a little bit about your college experience and, you know, kind of like what classes and stuff you enjoyed?
Yes, so my college experience, I started in Puerto Rico, my bachelor's degree in mechanical engineering. I went there for 2014 to 2017. Then I came to the States because I was visiting at the time. I got stuck in Chicago for a hurricane that destroyed back home in Puerto Rico. So I ended up transferring schools the spring 2018 due to that. Then from there, my mentor, Nancy Cohout, and at the time was my hiring manager, she hired me as an intern. And from there, I kind of started dabbling into design and architectural engineering.
Wow, that's really impressive. Yeah, I was so shocked. I listened to that podcast. The episode's called Do the Thing That Scares You. And you were speaking about how you didn't hear from your family for weeks after that hurricane happened. And I was like, oh my gosh, like I'm sure everybody who was listening to that had the same feeling of, I can't imagine the terror of, you know, not knowing if your family was okay during that hurricane. That sounds so emotional.
Yeah, it was a lot at the time. And ironically, I was like 3 weeks shy from turning 21. So I feel like I jumped straight into adulthood with that. It was very, I think, one of the most scary things that I've gone through so far. Not knowing if my family was even alive. Yeah.
Oh my gosh. That's terrifying. But speak a little bit about your experience once you, you know, kind of got through
college and, you know, you're going on this internship. What kind of work are you doing as an architectural engineer? Or, you know, like, what does that look like?
You mean as of today or when I was dabbling with like the internship in school?
Oh, yeah. Just like kind of still looking at that early on part of your career where you're in the internship in school.
Okay, perfect. Yes. So I was going to school full time. And well, before deciding to transfer schools, I should say, I was working full time for that MEP firm that I was hired as an intern. Nancy asked me, I started in October and then by December, she asked me if I, you know, if I should, I should consider transferring schools to Chicago and I could work part time, in the company. So I was like, okay, I mean, I'm fine with it, but I don't even know how the process will go when it comes to the college application. So she actually was the one that helped me through that process because her oldest daughter was also applying to college at the time. So yeah, I transferred school. I was working while I was going to school as well. Honestly, I looking back, I don't know how I did it. I guess it's part of living in the state of fight or flight. It kind of pushes you to do things. It's like either I make it work or I make it work.
Yeah.
I think that was kind of my grit for the past almost 4 years.
Wow.
But it was, oh, go ahead, sorry.
Oh, no, I just was saying, wow. Sorry. That sounded like it was loud on to you. I didn't mean to loud wow into the microphone.
No, you're fine. But yeah, that's pretty much how I did it. In between, it was good looking back because I realized that I could pay more attention as I was learning and practice and on my internships. I was learning how to use Revit. I was learning how to do load calculations, how ducting works, like how plumbing fixtures work, like what is, you know, GPMs? Why do I care about GPMs? So I started learning all that in practice. So when I went to school, having the technical background was like, oh, things are clicking easier. And I was able to pay extra attention to the classes that I knew I was like very interested in, like thermal, heat transfer, HVAC, you know, there was fluid mechanics. So I was able to kind of recognize that from the get-go.
Yeah. I heard you say in that podcast episode that you considered yourself a lifetime learner. I love that sentiment. Would you talk about how that has been something that has been rewarding in your career and why you feel that way?
Absolutely. I always joke that I will never strive to be the smartest person in the room. But I want to know who the smart person is. So I feel like that curiosity, it kind of translates to how I see everything. Like, oh, but how this works, but oh, or who knows this, that, this question, like who can answer? I feel like I've always been like that. And I don't know it, the way that it paid off, I would say. I mean, I was able to pivot careers. I've been able to like transfer schools. I've been like a lot of doors have been open for me just because of my willingness to keep learning and to be, I don't know, to have that interest in just always knowing more. There's no such thing as knowing everything. And I will be scared if someone claims that, honestly.
Yeah, you don't want to be. Honestly, sometimes it's not even a good idea to try to be the smartest person in the room or the, you know, unfortunately I see a lot of times that people who are the smartest and most technical engineers, oftentimes might struggle with the emotional intelligence piece or with the, you know, social interaction piece. Heard a funny joke about engineers the other day, and it was, how do you know who's the extroverted engineer? And the punchline is, they'll stare at your feet, not theirs.
That is so funny.
So, I don't know. I think that, you know, it's a weird thing being an engineer or working with technically competent people is, you know, a lot of people are technically competent. But I think that it's really hard to be good with networking, good with seeking out a mentor and kind of leaning into learning. So I'm happy to hear that those are big themes in your career.
Thank you.
So, for the people who are listening, the way we met was, you had reached out because you were going through a career change. Speak a little bit about that career change and, how you made the transition to fire and life safety, Jeyra, because I think it's pretty fascinating.
Yeah, so like you've mentioned, everything started because I was kind of researching about fire protection because I was in the midst of pivoting careers. So everything kind of started to put together in 2021, but this kind of started at the beginning of 2020. I was being interviewed for an internship position at Smith Group. That's the company that I'm working on right now. Actually, Nancy again was interviewing me, which is kind of very full circle. There's like a bunch of full circle moments in my career, I would say. She interviewed me and there were like three people. It was her, another mechanical engineer and a fire protection engineer. And then like the interview went and at the end, she mentioned like, oh, you should consider, looking into fire protection because it's a very small niche and I think you will be a good fit. And I'm like, what is fire protection? So I started researching and I'm like, oh, this seems very interesting and I'm curious to learn more. So I started also looking within the presentation. There's like a bunch of presentations that happen across our company on a very frequent basis where engineers and architects kind of discuss the projects that they've been involved in, like the challenges and so on and so forth. So seeing the fire protection engineers discussing like these very cool projects, like with this high level of complexity and kind of recognizing that as fire protection engineers, you don't have the same issues nor come with the same solutions. To me, it's very fascinating. So that's kind of how it started. And as I was doing my internship, even though it was only mechanical and I was doing mechanical and plumbing, I made the approach to the fire protection engineer, Stephen Barrett, which funny, he's my boss now. I reached out to him and I'm like, I'm interested in learning a little bit more about what you do. And he kind of started assigning little tasks about life safety here and there, but nothing too formal at that time. So then it was spring 2021. I asked him to mentor me because I was serious about making the change. I was like, okay, I'm pretty sure that I want to make the change. I don't know how I'm going to do it, but Steven, at the time, he also has a mechanical engineering background and bachelor, and he also pivoted to fire protection engineering. So my train of thought was like, okay, if he did it, I can do it as well, and I want to know how he did it. So that's kind of my idea of asking him to mentor me came from. And, he started, and he gave me like a bunch of resources, which I find that it was very nice of him. He made me like a huge list of like resources, webinars, like an FBA, like a bunch of like UL webinars, a bunch of things that I could kind of start learning and familiarizing with. So that's pretty much how things kind of unfolded up until the point where it's like, oh, okay, we have we need fire protection engineers. And I think, this will work. And, the opportunity came and I'm like, let's do it. And that's when I started kind of researching more into the practice of fire protection engineering. And I'm like, I love podcasts. So let me find a fire protection podcast. And I found yours. And it was very interesting to me because I already knew that as fire protection engineers, you are holistically solving a bunch of problems like life safety, fire alarm, smoke modeling, fire modeling. There's so many things that you're solving and working with as a fire protection engineer. I don't know, I could be talking all day, but to me it was very fascinating. And that's why I reached out to you. I'm like, oh my God, you're discussing this topic. Please, I want to know more.
Well, yeah, that's so many great points. I love that you're talking about how, saying that you have a mentor that was Originally a mechanical engineer, you know, turned fire protection engineer. And then that's kind of who you approach for a mentorship and your pursuit of the discipline. I think that's awesome. One of my biggest mentors in my life in fire protection engineering was originally a mechanical engineer, and she made the move to be the fire protection engineer. And so I think that's so funny. That's such a big common thing in the industry where the engineers of different disciplines or backgrounds kind of fumble their way into fire and life safety. But I was so impressed when you reached out and we had a conversation over the phone, and you were so well prepared. You went through a list of like maybe 6 or 7 really awesome questions about, you know, how to find resources, you know, what are competitive ways to advance in your career, the benefits, the pros and cons of higher education. I mean, you basically had kind of fleshed out, you know, how do I make the biggest bang for my career? And you were going to somebody and reaching out and trying to find those answers. And I was just kind of blown away by your ability to do that. I mean, usually nobody does that. And then they certainly don't do it in a nice way. They might barrage you on LinkedIn with like one word kind of questions or inquiries, but you know, you did it so politely and so succinctly and gracious and thoughtful of the time. And I was just like, wow, I'm so impressed by this person. So I was just like kind of blown away when you reached out.
That is so nice of you. Thank you. I feel like I strongly believe, I should say, that networking should be genuine relationships rather than, oh, I see that you, for example, I see that you're a fire protection engineer. Oh, yeah, please let me just connect and please give me a job. Like, I don't think that's how it should go. I strongly believe that there should be relationships developed within people. And over time, there's like, okay, something happens and it's like, oh, I know this person that can help me out, or, you know, vice versa. So yeah, I kind of see relationship like that way. So, but I appreciate that you tell me that, because I don't know, it comes very natural to me. So I wouldn't think that that's not as common.
Yeah, I think that's a superpower. That's probably your superpower and you don't even know it. But I think that's one of the, you know, I have sisters-in-law in college, and I always am trying to tell them, you know, to use LinkedIn, to use networking, to use mentorship, and to reach out to people that you, you know, want to learn how to do what they're doing. Because most people who are passionate professionals or, you know, really care about what they're doing, they want to help people out, you know. They want to see people who are willing to do the hard work, willing to take the advice and do good things and go out and conquer and be awesome. You know, we all want the field to have great people in it, and fire protection is in constant need of passionate professionals who care about fire and life safety and progressing the field. So I think it's just as invigorating for the person who gets to help out, you know. But I agree with what you're saying, you know. Approaching people for mentorship is a two-way street, you know. You have to kind of cultivate that rapport and relationship and be able to facilitate it from both sides, instead of just viewing it as transactional and I get what I need out of this relationship and, you know, then I move along or whatever. So it's more fruitful in that way that you're talking about, where you view it as more of a friendship, or, you know, you're not just taking.
Right. Yeah. It's like, okay, I'm taking knowledge, but hopefully there's something that I can contribute to the conversation as well to make it two way.
You inspire me. I wanted to say that you inspire me by, you know, because it took me so long for me to be able to do that, to reach out to people. And I was so terrified when I first started reaching out to people for the podcast. I was just like, oh my gosh, like I am just bothering this person and I feel so weird. I feel like I want to crawl out of my skin asking people to come on the podcast. So I think that's why I'm saying it's a superpower, and you should lean into that because it's really cool. And there's so many neat things that you can learn and ways to leverage that to grow in your career. So that's awesome.
Thank you. Thank you.
So we spoke a little bit about, you know, networking and mentoring and a little bit on the front side of your career. But so I want to know about, so when you started learning about fire protection, you know, you mentioned a couple of good resources, but where did you go to start really learning about the profession and kind of figuring out what it means to be a fire protection engineer?
The simple answer, my mentor, Stephen Barrett. I feel that that was my starting point when it comes to what a fire protection engineer is. He was my starting point, and from there, he kind of offered a bunch of resources that I could kind of start, like I've mentioned, kind of learning from. And just seeing in practice, I'm lucky to have, across offices, we have a huge team of fire protection engineers. And I find that those are my peers and my seniors are my best resources at hand. Then, you know, when it comes to the practice and interpretation and whenever I have questions along the way, also, of course, you need your NFPA, you know, knowledge, your code compliance. Since my background is in mechanical, I've been taking NFPA live courses, just for me to kind of understand a little bit better the code and interpreting the code. Like at webinars as well, YouTube, like I have a whole playlist of fire protection engineer interviews. I have podcasts like yours. I don't know. I love learning.
That's awesome. I think that's so great. You know, somebody, it's really surprising. I think that something that will help anybody, you know, progress and stay relevant in your career is that penchant to keep learning and to be curious. I think that it's something that has paid a lot of dividends in my career. So I think that's awesome. I wanted to ask about, have you had any involvement in like professional societies or, you know, anything like that for fire protection or any other professional pursuits?
Yes. I think looking back now that you've mentioned my, you know, the emotional intelligence, what I've learned about my soft skills, it's because of my engagement with professional organizations. Like I've been involved with engineering related organizations since I was a freshman in college. So I feel like that kind of built my soft skills tool set. And so to answer the question, I've been involved with like NSPE, National Professional Society of Professional Engineers, NFPA. I'm also a member now. ASHRAE, that's for mechanical, and ASPE, that is for plumbing as well. So I've been involved in, I am involved in a couple of professional organizations outside of course, work.
Yeah, that's good stuff. That sounds like you're, I love that you have remained involved with some different disciplines. I think that it's probably going to be a good resource for you always in your career that you had that experience as in mechanical, because, you know, there are plenty of people who are engineers who have more generalist kind of roles. You know, they do a little bit of everything. So it's a real benefit that you have that background where you've seen a little bit of design for mechanical and plumbing. I think that's awesome.
Yes, it plays to my advantage. And I can see it from like very early on that I'm right now in my career. It's like, oh, I can understand how things kind of combine holistically and within the MEP design. So it's pretty awesome. Like you eventually definitely has an advantage.
Yeah. Yeah. So I, you know, in listening to your other podcasts and, you know, taking a look at your LinkedIn, I've noticed that you have a big focus on, you know, equity and diversity and inclusion. I'd love to talk about what you see as places where fire protection can be better in this regard? You know, where do you see opportunities in that space for fire protection, fire and life safety?
I feel like there's a good space to, you know, help and increase these numbers when it comes to diversity, equity, and inclusion. If I go to the macro as engineering, there's only 2% of the workforce are Latina as engineer. So of course, if it's only 2% of engineering, like, it has to be like way less when it comes to like different niches, right? So I feel like the best thing, and something that I'm doing as well, is to put the word out there about what is, in this case, fire protection engineering. What is life safety engineering? Like, why is important? Like, what even is it? Like, what do we do? I feel like the best thing that we can do at this moment is to put the word out there about our profession and about what we do. Because once people know better, at least they have options to do better.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I think that the industry is really struggling to figure out how we get the word out about what a good thing fire protection is, and, you know, how much opportunity there is. And, you know, it kind of astounds me of the disparity in engineers between even just men and women, let alone, you know, people of, you know, a diverse range of
backgrounds. People of color, typically.
Yeah. And so to me, I'm just like, how do we get the word out in general about the industry, and how do we make it more inclusive and bring people in? But it's, I think there's so much opportunity, and I just want to let people know that, you know, it's a good field to be in. I don't know, maybe that's some touchy-feely stuff, but...
No, I feel like, honestly, what you're doing right here is, this is great, like... If you think about it, like, because we've met because I started listening to your podcast, and I started learning about what is fire protection engineering, and it's kind of a full circle moment. So in a way, you're also contributing, because I am a Latina who's stepping into fire protection engineering. And, you know, this is, to me, I'm a grassroots type of person. And in my eyes, this is how change happens. When you impact, like, you only need to impact one person's life to create change.
Yeah, I think it's important. You know, we do really interesting and meaningful work, and I think we just need to lower that barrier for access for people to get the knowledge and to be curious and to pursue the field. So I appreciate you saying that. That is meaningful to me. It feels good to hear that. It's always sometimes you feel like you're doing these interviews kind of in a vacuum, because, you know, I get to speak to these great people, and then I release it, and then it's out into the wind, and it's gone, and then it's on to the next week. What's the next topic?
But right.
It always is so nice. Sometimes people will reach out and say nice things, and it makes my day, but it's, and that's enough of a reward. It feels good. But anyways, enough self-gratification, but.
Hey, it's always good. Patting yourself on the shoulder is always good.
Well, Jeyra, I've been so excited to hear, you know, kind of, where you've been, and you know, now you've talked a little bit about what you're doing now. You know, you don't have to speak any specifics, but I'd love to hear about some of the project work you're involved with now. And you could talk, you know, real broadly about occupancy types or general building types. You don't have to get into specifics about specific projects, but I'd like to hear about what kind of projects you're involved with now.
Yeah, as of now, I'm mostly engaged with healthcare and offices and business occupancy. That's pretty much what I've been involved in. I've been doing fire protection, but I've been more involved into the life safety, which I really find fascinating. Just not only because of the complexity, of course, but of the, to me, there's a lot of complexity since English is not my first language. So there's not only the layer of the technical complexity, but also the language in my case, which I find very interesting. Wow. So, yeah.
That's quite, I didn't even think about that as, I mean, it's hard enough to read these code books if English is your first language. I mean, they're so dry and, you know, formal most of the time about how they're describing these things, and they can be kind of confusing requirements or not real clear requirements. And so I'd never even thought about, you know, what if the English is not your first language, you know, how much harder does that make these random code interpretations?
We found a solution, meeting me and Steven, because I brought that to his attention. I'm like, I think that I'm struggling a lot with the language, like the language barriers being a huge thing. And he proposed, like, is there like an FBA handbook in Spanish? And I'm like, I have no idea. And there it is. So yeah, I have a Spanish and FBA code compliance. Yeah, I have a couple.
Oh, nice. Yeah, that's a good tip. That's a good tip. I love hearing about that. Maybe that's a good tip for other people too who might be having that same issue. You know, I don't know if you've heard it, but there is another Spanish-speaking fire alarm podcast that I've seen out there too. And, you know, I was like, man, I wish I could speak Spanish. I would love to talk with these people about fire and life safety, but I follow them on LinkedIn. I'll have to find it and throw it in the show notes. But yeah, you said you'd heard of them?
Yes. Yeah, I think I've heard an episode, you know, scrambling on the Spotify world. Uh-huh. So yeah, this is another thing. Sorry. I was like, wait.
Okay.
On the street. I'm thinking I'm
no okay. worries. Sorry. I'll find it and throw it in the show notes for anybody who's interested. But it's awesome that some people are starting to get out there and get into it. Well, that sounds really fascinating that you've been involved in healthcare work. That's some of the most challenging fire and life safety work there is out there. Hospitals and healthcare is so nuanced and complex when it comes to fire protection. It's really challenging.
I love it. I like it so much. I find it very fascinating how, I don't know, I tend to see problems and solutions almost like pieces of a puzzle, and almost in my head, like, oh, how do you rotate the piece to make it fit? So to me, kind of, you know, navigating healthcare and like life safety and, oh, you know, 101 and how that works is very interesting. How, again, you don't have the same solution for the, you know, you can have the same exact problem and you will find like different solutions every time because the constraints are different.
Yeah, it's definitely strange. You'd think you'd run out of different problems, but it's always something new. It's almost never the same thing over and over again. It always feels like you're struggling with some new little snippet of, random sprinkler application or fire alarm interface. For this week, I was dealing with coiling smoke doors for opening protections for elevators. And I'm like, oh my gosh, never had to deal with this before. What is UL 1784? What is NFPA 80? You know, I've never had to deal with this. Why, you know, do we really need this? Where's this at in the building code? You know, and just, I've been doing this for coming up on 6 years and it's still encountering those new problems. So it's really fun to just be kind of challenged like that.
Yes, it's very interesting. I agree with you. I don't know. The more that I kind of start dabbling into it, the more curious that I am, the more fascinated that I am with the profession. And I kind of keep confirming, like, oh, I made the right move here. It doesn't feel like work for the most part. And, you know, there's a lot of learning that happens on my free time because, again, I do recognize that I come from a different background. So, and it really doesn't feel like work. So, yeah, that kind of keeps confirming that I made the right choice here.
That's awesome. Well, yeah, that extra work is going to pay off. I know without a doubt. I know it is already paying off for you. So that's a good deal. But so I wanted to talk about, you know, so we've talked about where you've been. We talked about, you know, what you're working on now. Where do you see, like, what are your big and bold dreams for what you want to do in the next 5 years and, you know, in line with kind of becoming a better FPE and professional, you know, what's your 5 years plan kind of look like for Jeyra?
It is interesting because if you would have asked me that question a year ago, I would have told you like step by step my next 5 years. Now I see it more of like, you know, life doesn't have to be that strict. The only thing that for sure I know I will become a professional engineer within the next 5 years. And you know, the rest, I will keep showing up as my best as I've been doing this whole time and just see where, you know, it gets me. So far, I can't complain.
That's a good way to take it. It's good to have some goals, but it's hard to be too set on any one thing. Life is pretty wild. I understand what you're saying. I don't know. I feel like I've always kind of had like, oh, what's next 2-3 years? But then life always kind of has its own decisions, so
yes,
that's a good thing. But yeah, so have you taken your FE yet, or have
I'm taking it within the next 2 months.
Oh my goodness! So you're in the thick of it then.
Yes, I am.
Which one are you taking? Are you taking the other disciplines? Are you taking the mechanical one?
Oh, I'm taking other disciplines. I'm going to other disciplines.
That's a good idea. I think that the mechanical one's supposed to be much harder. I took other disciplines and passed other disciplines, and you know, surprisingly, there was one fire alarm question in there. It was like a battery calc question, and I was like, wow, I really did not expect anything to do with fire protection in this exam. So there actually ended up being something in there.
Oh, that's good to know, though. Thank you.
yeah. That's awesome. Well, that's exciting. It's good. Good to get that FE out of the way as close as you can to school, because it feels like that stuff starts to go, even though you could probably still pick it up if you crank out enough practice problems.
Exactly.
Yeah. So as somebody who has really excelled in kind of seeking out professional development and just learning and growing, what kind of advice would you give to a professional that's maybe, you know, in a similar situation in their career, Jeyra?
So I would start with being proactive, try your best to be reliable. Also, you need to understand and recognize that at this stage, you really know nothing. And, you know, that is totally okay. That is expected. Definitely ask a bunch of questions, communicate effectively and very clearly, and understand to the point what are the expectations of the task that you are being assigned, for example. I feel like, yeah, you're not expected to know the answers and you're definitely going to make mistakes, but at least that you're being proactive. It's, you know, you're showing up already and it shows interest. So I would say, being proactive, ask questions. And something that Steve tells me a lot is that I am building my knowledge brick by brick. So yeah, just build that toolkit on a brick by brick basis.
That's a great piece of advice. I love that. I've been in the process of onboarding new staff at my company, and she's just, I can just see it, you know, every week there's a different brick that, you know, or set of bricks that have been laid down with whatever it is, Revit or, you know, fire suppression system components or, you know, general construction terms and, you know, project deliverables and what that means. And so I think it's easy to be disheartened by how much stuff there is to learn, but you just got to remember that, it just takes time, and you gotta build that knowledge brick by brick.
It is a daily practice, though, because as high achievers, sometimes it gets hard to not have unrealistic expectations, which is that's when it's perfect timing to have mentors to call you out in those type of scenarios.
Yeah, I remember, and it's unfortunate too that when you're in like that early part of your career and, you know, you're just like, I just really want to know this answer now. Like, can I know now? Like, can I understand it now? And then it just is so, it just doesn't come easy. And then, you know, it's kind of interesting that the more you keep learning, it just kind of, starts to, you start to retain that knowledge just faster and faster and faster. And then the next thing you know it, that thing that you dreaded, maybe it was doing a fire riser detail your first time and you didn't, you know, had struggled with all the parts and pieces and couldn't understand why some of it was code required. And now that's, you know, just easy or a rote task and you don't even worry about it. So it's weird how that change happens slowly. And then by the time it happens, you don't even realize it and you're on to the next thing.
Yes, 100%. I was actually thinking about that this week because it's like, wow, like 4 months ago, I really did not know anything. And now it's like, oh, I know a couple of things that I did not know like back in September. So it's been pretty cool to kind of look back and see how much I've learned so far.
That's awesome. I like that. So I always like to end the episode with a couple of different professional development topics. And it's kind of been a theme throughout our entire conversation, but just a couple things here to round out the interview. First one is, what do you see as a meaningful trend in fire and life safety? We talked about a couple of things of macro level, what we're seeing in the industry off air before the podcast started, but I'd love to hear your thoughts on that.
So I feel like right now I am a fly on the wall when it comes to these conversations, but what I've noticed is there's a lot of conversations when it comes to fire modeling and egress modeling. I feel like that's going, if it's not already, it's going to be a trend. I feel like once AI keeps evolving, we're going to keep leveraging on those tools to, even though it's not required, it's always a good practice. You know, it's safety, so we should be as accurate as possible. So I would say, fire modeling.
Ooh, that's cool. I like that. I wish I knew how to fire model. I haven't. The firm I work for now doesn't do much performance-based design, but I think it's so interesting. I would love to learn about that subject. I think you're right about how it's on the uptick.
In my company, we have an expert in fire modeling, and he's right now kind of starting to train the younger crowd. And of course, I'm into that pool, so I'm very excited to start learning about fire modeling. I'm not gonna lie to you.
Ooh, you're gonna have to tell me how it goes. That sounds really interesting. Yeah, it's kind of like that really neat kind of like computer programming nerdy stuff that like you always see in magazines. They got cool diagrams of like zone modeling and CFD and stuff. And so I've always had a real fascination with that. That's neat. You'll have to tell me how it goes.
Yes, I will.
But so we talked already about, you know, you said that your biggest resource has been your mentor, but in learning, you know, what's helped you the most? Has it been those code books that are in Spanish, or, you know, what has been your thoughts on those training courses from NFPA?
So I took the first one. It was a 101 on the life safety one, and it was amazing. It was worth every single penny. I would encourage everyone who's interested in learning more about, you know, the handbooks to, you know, enroll and take these courses, because it was a lot of things clicked for me after, you know, I finished that course. I would say YouTube as well. I've learned a bunch of things from YouTube. There's a lot of UL webinars that are for free. I also think that NFPA also offers some webinars that are free, but I'm not entirely sure. LinkedIn as well. I know the Linda part of it. I've watched a couple of things. And the reps also have like a bunch of good resources when it comes, like I've seen fire pumps, videos, that thing like fire alarm, like there's like a bunch of free resources that you can start learning from if you're interested about the profession and the field.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. There's a lot of professional societies like American Fire Alarm Association and National Fire Sprinkler Association and like American Fire Sprinkler Association, like they'll host a couple of free webinars, even though probably the lion's share of them are paid for. They'll still, like, even NFPA will have free webinars. I forget, they had a really good one about warehouse fire protection last year, I remember attending. And so also, you know, there are other life safety podcasts out there, fire and life safety podcasts, like NFPA and ICC have podcasts. So yeah, there's a lot of good resources out there for fire protection professionals, or at least if you're willing to dig a little bit, they're out there. Right. But it's hard to know.
Yes, I feel like these type of efforts, like you putting the information out there, and you know, other people also putting themselves and their knowledge out there, is definitely contributing into this conversation and into making change happen.
Yeah, I sure hope so. I mean, a lot of the reason why I started this endeavor was because when I started, I was like a year in, and I was like, well, I kind of get the basics, but I really don't understand the big picture. And it's kind of really bugging me that I don't get the big picture, and I want to know now. And so this has been my way of trying to talk to people from a variety of backgrounds and you know, what we do, and also outside of what we do. And so I hope somebody finds it interesting and, you know, can help try to facilitate that discussion around different resources and let people know about where they can go find other good stuff, because yeah, that's the goal. But anyways, Jeyra, I think that mostly does it for the questions that I had prepared, but is there anything that you would like to talk about in conclusion, or anything that you would like to ask me, not to put you on the spot?
Actually, I'm very interested about, it's a question about you, like, how do you see kind of things moving? Because before we started recording, we were talking about working remote and the adjustment, like, How do you see yourself kind of moving forward with this type of environment, or like the adjustment, I don't know, how do you see yourself moving forward?
I think that working remotely has just become something that companies who really want to grow and stay competitive in the industry, they're gonna have to wrap their heads around it, right? Because if you want to be competitive on a national or an international perspective, you're going to need to embrace some level of remote work in order to attract talent. So for me, I like the hybrid system. You know, maybe the majority of the week you're in the office, but you have the option or the ability to work remotely and, you know, have that flexibility. I think that is a fabulous benefit for workers, for people who have lives, or maybe you have sick kids, or you have a repair person needs to come to your house or apartment. And so I think that it's not going away. Remote work's not going away. I think it's here to stay. So it's interesting. I think there's pros and cons to it, like a little bit of what we talked about before the pod got started, you know. There's inherent efficiencies and inefficiencies to working remote or working in the office. So, I think it's a kind of a double-edged sword. There's good things and there's bad things about it.
Yeah. Actually, this made me think about another question. Sorry. So since, you know, a lot of us are starting our careers for the most part remotely, what advice would you give us?
Ooh, yeah, that's a good question. I think, you know, I think fostering that mentor relationship remotely is a lot harder, because in person, people can kind of stop by or see when you're floundering, but remotely, it is a lot harder for people to, you know, kind of engage and, you know, be connected with that mentor-mentee kind of a relationship to build that rapport. So I think my piece of advice would be to really lean into finding somebody who has the ability to mentor. Not everybody kind of has that disposition or inclination to want to take on somebody and really teach them a lot. Some people are just more naturally geared for that. So seek out that person that you see has some proclivity for teaching and learning and really try to engage that person, and don't wait for them to ask you how you're doing or if you have it all figured out. Like you were saying earlier, be proactive, engage your mentor, engage your network for solving problems, and, you know, really focus in on getting the task done. And you know, don't wait. Don't be a hand-fed bear. Don't wait for people to bring you work. Go, you know, knock on their door and say, hey, what can I do? You know, how can I create value? So I think that would be my advice.
Thank you. Thank you. I appreciate it a lot.
Yeah, no worries. Awesome. Well, Jeyra, I just want to thank you so much for coming on the podcast. I'm really excited to see what you're going to do in your career. I know it's going to be big things, but yeah, thank you for coming on the podcast.
Thank you so much for having me, Gus. It's been a pleasure. I hope we keep in touch and keep chatting.
Without a doubt.
Thanks for listening, everybody. Be sure to share the episode with a friend if you enjoyed it. Don't forget that fire protection and life safety is serious business. The views and opinions expressed on this podcast are by no means a professional consultation or a codes and standards interpretation. Be sure to contact a licensed professional if you are getting involved with fire protection and/or life safety. Thanks again, and we'll see you next time.